Hi, I'm John Belanger, Adjunct Senior Fellow in International and National Security Law here at the Council on Foreign Relations and the former legal advisor of the Department of State. I'm here today with Judge Joan Donoghue, who was elected in September of 2010 as a judge of the International Court of Justice in The Hague. Joan had previously served for many years at the Department of State and at the Treasury Department, and is the first American woman on the International Court of Justice. Judge Donoghue, welcome. It's nice to have you here at the Council on Foreign Relations.
Well, thank you, John. It's great to be here.
Could you say a word about the history of the United States' involvement with the International Court of Justice, and maybe just a quick word about the kinds of cases that the United States has had before the court?
Sure. Actually, it was the United States, along with the British, who were strong advocates for the idea of a world court originally around the turn of the 20th century. And that said, there's always been a little bit of a love-hate relationship in the sense that within the U.S. there have been a range of views about the idea of a world court. Was it a good thing? Would it help bring about peace? Or would it be a body that infringed on U.S. sovereignty, and that those themes have persisted since the beginning, I think. In terms of cases that the court hears, the bulk of our work is in handling cases that are called contentious cases, which look a little bit like a civil case in the sense that we have one state bringing a case against another state. So not a criminal case. We don't hear any criminal cases. We have, for example, a case that Australia has brought against Japan, complaining about Japan's whaling practices. We generally have quite a few boundary dispute cases, sometimes land boundaries, sometimes maritime boundaries. And those are, of course, the kinds of cases where there's a high legal content because frequently we're being asked to interpret a treaty or to apply the law of the sea. Also, they're very politically sensitive. Quite a lot of hostility and emotion can be associated with border disputes. We have a very busy docket right now with cases coming from around the world on a variety of different issues, a unifying theme being that we apply international law, not national law.
Now, you mentioned that the United States has had its ups and downs with the court. A number of years ago, the United States withdrew from the general jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice as part of the Nicaragua case. But in more recent years, we've had quite a few cases before the International Court of Justice. Do you sense that the United States has been engaging more with the International Court of Justice in recent decades?
Well, again, back to the idea of a love-hate relationship, the United States did accept the court's jurisdiction generally after World War II, but then withdrew that acceptance in the 1980s in the wake of the Nicaragua case. But the court also has jurisdiction over cases by virtue of provisions of treaties that give the court jurisdiction to decide cases arising under those particular treaties, and that's where the activity has been with the United States in recent years. Do I see the U.S. engaging more? There certainly have been a number of cases in which the U.S. has been a defendant recently, especially cases arising out of consular notification with respect to individuals who are facing a death penalty in the United States. And although the United States didn't win those cases, I think the way that the U.S. approached the cases is certainly something I would describe as a very active and engaged manner, including when the U.S. Lost a case, making considerable efforts to bring the United States into compliance despite serious obstacles within the U.S. as a matter of our own constitutional system, our federalist system.
And of course, I know those cases very well. Let's drill in a little bit more about U.S. attitudes on the court. We've got some people in the United States who've been disappointed, many of them international law professors and others who were very, very supportive of international institutions, were very disappointed after the United States withdrew from the International Court of Justice and have been less active and think we ought to be submitting more disputes to the International Court of Justice, that it can be more useful. On the other hand, many conservatives are quite suspicious of the International Court of Justice, feel that it's politicized and maybe even an infringement of U.S. sovereignty. What would you say to both of these groups, and particularly what you see, frankly, you spent more years of your life at the State Department on the outside, as the utility of the court, despite what flaws it might have from an American perspective?
Well, I think when the idea of a world court first emerged, it was the only alternative to ad hoc arbitration of a known dispute. And so these days, the world looks very different because you've got all kinds of ways that states can deal with disputes, sometimes specialized. For example, they can go to the World Trade Organization, or they can go to the Law of the Sea Tribunal. Sometimes there are regional bodies that can handle matters. Sometimes there are quasi-judicial mechanisms. There are the international criminal courts. There are courts where individuals can bring cases, usually complaining about human rights violations. There are investor state tribunals. There's a full range of tribunals that didn't exist. So generally speaking, what I try to do is locate the court in this broader constellation of mechanisms and bodies out there. And I think recognize that there are these differing views within the United States and differing perspectives, and then try to turn the focus on the kinds of things that a court like ours can especially contribute. We're a traditional form of dispute resolution through adjudication in a court. Our proceedings are public. It's a way for states to shift the accountability, for example, giving back an island to the neighbors, to a third party. So there are times where this mechanism may seem to a particular state to be exactly what they want. They want to seek to get the World Court seal of approval on their legal views, for example. And there are other times where states may say, this is not the kind of body we want to be before. And I don't think things need to be seen in a binary way. Mm-hmm. These are choices that states make around the world on a daily basis. Legal advisors, mm-hmm. your former mm-hmm. counterparts, mm-hmm. face those choices. And it is an option that's among those that needs to be analyzed and considered when figuring out how to address disputes peacefully, which is, of course, a key objective for any international mm-hmm. lawyer.
And so, last question, somewhat more personal. You've been on the court now for just a little bit over a year. You, of course, spent 20 years on the outside and had some cases that you worked on that were before the court. What surprised you the most now that you're a member of the inner circle of these 15 judges from different countries as you work together with them? What's surprised you most now being a judge on the court?
Well, I'd say from the outside, when litigants look at our court or any other, there's an intense effort to try to predict outcomes, and how will various judges vote. And in my own experience with that, with the ICJ, the tendency is to give huge weight to the nationality of the judge. And it makes sense because that's one of the things we know about the judges. We don't necessarily know that much else about them. But what has struck me is really that it's 15 individuals. Nationality isn't irrelevant, but it's relevant maybe for a different reason than people think. Our nationalities shape the way we think because of the schooling we have, the kind of legal training we have. Certainly our perspectives on issues are influenced by our nationality, but we are so much more than that. So I have a colleague who is a former foreign minister, for example, and he brings a perspective mm-hmm. that differs from the perspective of someone who's largely been a foreign ministry lawyer, and there are a number of people like myself who have that background. There are a number of colleagues who were professors. They bring a different perspective, and several colleagues were judges in national courts, and they offer a perspective that can be quite different. So it's really, I suppose, recognizing that it's an amalgam of 15 individuals as opposed to judges from 15 nationalities. That is, I think, one of the most interesting insights that I've gained since I got to the court.
And unlike the UN Security Council, where the U.S. member is representing the United States, you may be an American. You were nominated by the members of the United States National Group, but you're not representing the United States on the court.
Right. I tend to say to people that when I was at the State Department, I served my country by representing it, and now I serve my country by being independent of it.
Well, Judge Donoghue, thanks very much for being with us today at the Council on Foreign Relations.